Jenny, help me translate, please. 我们过去在十四年过程当中，协助了大概有两千多户的原住民跟低收入户的在灾后的重建。
So for the past 14 years, we have helped 2,000. We have reconstructed about 2,000 units of post-disaster reconstruction with the Aboriginal tribes and the lower income.
在灾区我们面对的问题其实并不是当时受灾的状况，其实是普遍化的一般老百姓的问题。
So in the post-disaster reconstruction, we confronted the problem is accumulated from the past, and not only just the immediate circumstance.
也就是平常百姓家的问题。
Which means it's like the ordinary problem from their ordinary life.
在中国大陆过去三十年，农村盖的房子是城市的四到五倍。
So for the past 30 years, farmer has built 4 times more floor areas than the urban areas in China.
但是没有人注意这件事情。
But it's overlooked.
大家都关注到城市建设。
Most people are focusing on the construction in urban area.
农民穷一辈子之力就盖这种房子，不合理，不环保，而且不安全的房子。
So the farmers spend all their life saving to build very unsustainable houses like this.
而且非常不安全，一遇到地震的话，它就会倒塌。
And it's not earthquake resilient.
这是我们在灾区看到的状况。传统的房子都没有问题，但是新建的话基本上全部垮掉。
So this is what we encounter in the disaster site when the traditional houses is sound and the modern houses is collapsed.
到底什么是现代的住宅？
So what's modern building?
这个是惹的祸，是住宅建筑惹的祸，这是可以避免的。
So disaster also caused by architecture.
可能很多人都觉得说农民他会自己盖房子，传统的建筑盖得非常好。
Most people think the traditional dwelling, the villager that be able to build by themselves.
但是时代在改变，材料在改变，生活价值在改变，所以新的建筑到底是什么？
But the time is shifting and the value is also changing. So what's a new value?
但是我们现在的建筑的专业的人，事实上是没有办法踩到这个领域里头。
And most of the professional trained architects, it's hard for us to tap into this discipline.
海地的状况一样。
Like the problem in Haiti.
第三世界的状况一样，也就是说，全世界大概70%的房子跟我们的建筑专业是无关的。
So the question is, 75% of housing is unrelated to our professional discipline.
我们试图找出一个方法，专业的人能够进到这个领域来。
So what we do is we try to create a platform for the professional can enter.
另外一个挑战就是说，当我们思考这个问题的时候，可持续的建筑是必须要考虑到的。
At the same time, we have to the sustainable construction is something that we have to think about.
它不只是建筑技术的问题，绿建筑的问题。
It's not a question of just technology or green architecture.
它必须跟文化经济社会因素考虑进去。
So related to social, economical, environmental, culture problem.
当然这个解决之道是我的想象，可能很多人会有不一样的意见。
So this is just a solution that we have come up with.
第一个就是我们必须把传统我们设计师的观念价值体系做一个反转。
We had to reverse the thinking of the relationship between the designer and the user.
我们设计师都通常都是非常的强调个人的自我意识，忘了使用者。
We often focus on our individual value and forgot about the user.
这不是很简单的概念。
It's not a very simple idea.
我们试图在学校里头教学，把这个方法 重新设计一套教学方式，教导学生，改变传统的一个思维方式。
We try to do this also through teaching in school, in artificial school, and you know, teach a student a new way of thinking about responsibility for the architects.
这个要训练的。也就是说，专业者他只做部分、局部的事情，并不是把所有的设计的工作完成。
Which means the architects only provide a central platform, and but leaving not finishing everything.
建构一个平台，让使用者人可以参与。
This platform can allow the user to participate.
不只是说他的创造力，他的劳动力都可以参与到这里边来。
So including their creativity and their labor.
这里边两个重要的重点，这个平台的一个要点就是它必须有开放性，另外就是它必须构法是很简单的。
And two important points here is an open system and simple construction.
这个大家都知道的概念，但是一个世纪以来，它事实上没有做被很好的发挥。
The open system, you know, from the modernist idea, but hasn't really fulfilled its potential.
这个是现在的状况。
And this is the open system that we have arrived now.
即使是前苏联，这个开放的体系，照理讲应该在社会主义国家应该会很好的执行的，但事实上并不然。
This is the Khrushchev apartments built by the Soviets, and.So as we thought, like open system architecture should be a success in a socialist country, but it's a failure as well.
像这种建筑是没有办法修改，而且它没有办法跟着时代的改变而改变。
You can update or fix those buildings, and they can change through the time.
所以大量的这种建筑就等待拆除。
A lot of those buildings just waiting to be demolished.
也就是它没有开放性。
Which is, means it's not open system.
这是我们的设计的一个钢构。那其他的现场可以按照当地的状况，可以很弹性的使用它的材料，甚至于它可以构件可以移动。
So on the left is the lightweight steel framework that we have designed, and on the right is when we work.With local material and there can implement any creativities and local resources to infill the structure.
它可以跟传统的工艺跟智慧结合在一起。
And also combine with traditional handcrafts.
所以我们讲开放性并不是只有构造的开放性。
So the open system is not just a construction not only talking about it's a construction problem.
有弹性，这个是在我们在四川盖的，因为农民灾后在重建呢，银行并没有给他贷款的，所以他要逐年完成。
And this is in Sichuan when we work on the disaster reconstruction when the villager didn't get any loans or funding from the bank, so they have to build incrementally throughout the years.
另外一个就是我们强调的必须简化。
We really emphasizing simplification.
因为现代建筑用的材料各方面来讲，它有技术门槛的。
There's a the modern architecture there's like a technical level that sometimes not easy to understand by the villagers.
如果没有简化的话，所有的居民参与是没有办法做到的。
So if we don't simplify this construction, it'sHow to talk about participation?
不只是构造上的，就是生产工具跟工法也要简化。
So not only talking about structurally, but also the production of this structure.
我们知道，像这种轻钢构的那个加工的工厂，它的投资是非常大的。
Usually, for a lightweight steel factory, there's a lot of investment need to put in the beginning.
我们必须设计一套的生产方式，让它简化。
So, we also have to simplify this production line.
这个是一个月可以生产500户的一个活动的轻钢构的工厂。
So this is a mobile production factory that can produce
500户.
So we can produce 500 units in 1 month.
同时社区的人可以参与它的生产。
The community can participate in this production.
我们介绍几个实际的项目。
Excuse me, Jenny, we have just about 2-3 minutes left.
只有两分钟。So we'll just go through some projects.
这个是四川的一个村寨。
This is in Yangliu Village in Sichuan.
除了钢构以外，这个都是他们自己用到传统的工艺做起来的。
So, besides the live steel structure, everything else was finished by the villager himself.
而且是旧的材料，回收的材料用的。
They recycle the old material.
每一户都不太一样。
And every unit is different.
这个是另外就是一个项目，是在台湾的水灾后的原住民部落的重建。
This is Aboriginal reconstruction in Taiwan.
这个是房子。
Those are housing.
这个才是家。
But this is home.
自己加工过的才是家。
After they have modified the houses, and then it becomes their home.
这个是海地的项目，大家都知道的最大的问题。
This is the Haiti project that we have proposed.
这是我们的提案。
And this is our proposal.
我们只提供部分的材料，其他全部靠自己做。
We only provide the material, and then they will finish the rest.
它可以用建渣打碎以后，加一点水泥填到墙里头。
To recycle the rubble from the site.
因为他们有很多的土地问题、社会问题，这个外人没有办法做的。
Difficult to rely on the outer sources because they have many the land issues.
我们很快看一下那个一个影片，就是他们施工的状况，就是杨柳村的施工。
So we just gonna go through the video. This is a Yangliu village.
组织了村民选拔施工队成员，明天要在谢老师的团队指导下自己组装轻钢架子。
村民来了来，要紧哈轩，已经有五个人了。我也保佑你嘛。先报名吧，人多了我们再筛选。
杨柳是我之前已经待了两个星期了，现在是第三个星期。那么我是和这里的村民一起做基础，然后现在和他们一起组架子。主要我还觉得这里的干部群众关系都挺融合，就是挺和谐的。当主人就是天生挺乐观的，他就是喜欢开玩笑，喜欢快快乐乐的干活，他不喜欢绷着脸干活的，就是这样。
因为我们这套工作方式，盖房子方式比较特别，只要我们第一栋我们带他做过以后，他完全可以掌握。像今天立这个架子就知道，前两架三架比较生疏啊，接下来就很快了，掌握诀窍以后就很快了，完全没有问题。
就好像今天上午我们看他们组第一个架子还很不顺利吧，可是现在组到第六个， 大家已经是很自然而然的就形成了一个小团队，有一个团队协作。
那个盖房子的都是没有请外边的人，都是自己的，
全部是自己嘴里面的，自己盖嘛。
我们因为我们在农村也都待过很长时间了，所以对他们盖房子技术我们一直都不怀疑，只是到实际状况的时候，让我们更吃惊的就是说，地震以后很多年轻人全部都在外面打工，全部都回到四川来，回到村子里的参与重建。那他们的那种工作能力啊，技术能力相对之下都超出想象。
那你家住哪里？
住在北京。
住在北京。我也去过北京。
是吗？
对，北京打工嘛，也是在工地上干。
Excuse me, Jenny, we're really sorry, but we're really exceeding time limit. Thank you.
Thank you.